Thank you, Sherry. Welcome, everyone. It's Sunday morning yet again. You're supposed to say good morning. Thank you. Very good. You just need permission, that's all. So anybody watching us online, good morning to you as well on this Lord's Day. If you're new to Grace Community, we hope that as you leave out there, and it's on the right, I believe now, there's a gift bag for you. Make sure you pick that up. Also in your bulletin, you should find this Keep in Touch card. If you could fill that out, drop that in the basket, that would be helpful as well. Who was here on Friday night? Ooh, wow, almost all of you, wow. Did you like the new star that they presented? Oh, Pastor Cliff was the star of the whole show.
Oh yeah.
And I hate to tell you, but this is his last Sunday. Him and Gold Rush are going on the road. Ooh, that's cold. And it is cold out, so I guess it works. But if you enjoyed the last two concerts, coming up on the 2nd of December, which is a Christmas month at 4 o'clock, is Dan Reed and his Dixieland Hotshots are going to be doing a Christmas presentation for us. And if you ever heard Dan Reed, he's probably the number one trumpet player here in the valley. He spent 20 years on the Love Boat as the music director. He did. That's true. He was the music director on the Love Boat for 20 years, and now he's he's with us now, and he's outstanding. So if you've never heard him in this group, you don't want to miss it. And I want to encourage Tuesday morning's 9:45 in the prayer room back there with what's going on. And Tuesday's also election day, so that's a great day to come that morning and pray and seek the Lord's face relative to those issues as well. When all hope of restoration was lost, history took an altogether unexpected turn. In the midst of death, God came in human form, not to punish or destroy the traitor race, but to weave even the darkest of sins into a tapestry of his glory. Sunday mornings now, we just began this morning at 8:30, the Sunday morning small group that meets back in that room back over there. Everyone is invited to be part of that small group and come on Sunday mornings at 8:30. History truly is his story, God's story, the greatest story ever told. Find your place in the adventure and discover amazing life that never ends as we look at the history of God's epic story. So I'm going to ask you to stand right now and greet one another. And then we'll come back for the call to worship. okay, you can hit it. All right, we're gonna come back together and continue on with a call to worship. As we begin our call to worship this morning, grace and truth came by Jesus Christ. For it is by grace you have been saved.
God raised us up with Christ and seated us with him in the heavenly realms in Christ Jesus.
In order that in the coming ages he might show the incomparable riches of his grace expressed in his kindness to us in Christ Jesus. By the washing of regeneration and renewing of the Holy Spirit.
For the grace of God has appeared and offers salvation to all people.
He saved us through the washing of rebirth and the renewal by the Holy Spirit, whom he poured out on us generously through Jesus Christ our Savior. Let us worship the Lord in spirit and in truth. You can remain standing.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Thank you for standing. Then I don't have to tell you. This morning, the three hymns that we have chosen to sing have a message about Christ, our Redeemer and friend. And we don't sing these hymns real often, but some of you may not even be familiar with them. And they carry a message of grace, redemption, and love. In Romans 5:20, we read, "Where sin abounded, grace abounded much more." Let's sing together that marvelous grace of our loving Lord. Has for sin atonement made. We are redeemed, the price is paid. What a wonderful Savior. Christ has for sin atonement made. What a wonderful Savior. that you know it, let's sing the last verse. He gives me overcoming power. What a wonderful Savior. And triumph in each trying hour. What a wonderful Savior. What a wonderful Savior is Jesus, my Jesus. What a be seated. We sing of his grace, his atonement for sin, and of course his immeasurable love. Praise God, great is the measure of our Father's love. Think about his love, think about his goodness. Think about his grace that's brought us through. For as high as the heavens above, so great is the measure of our Father's love. Great is the measure of our Father's love.
I've had a lot of people tell me I'm lucky, but I tell them I'm chosen. My name is Karabo Moretlani. I was born in Lesotho, Southern Africa, and was raised in the villages. When I was about 5 years old, I lost my father, and not long after my father's death, my mother left me at my grandmother's house, and I never saw her for years. So my grandmother became a mother. She taught me a lot of things, including how to read and write, but most importantly, she taught me about God. Loneliness in my life began when I lost my grandma, the woman who raised me. I had to say goodbye to my love, to my grandmother. Then a year after my grandma's passing, my mother also passed away. I was faced with the sad reality of being an orphan, which is something that I dreaded the most. I had a home and a house in the villages, but I had no parents. I was alone. My uncle brought me into his home in the city. It was there in the city that I met a friend, actually, who invited me to a church. There was a truck filled with these shoeboxes. I received a shoebox myself. And I remember that shoebox filled one of the holes in my heart, and that was the hope of having something that belonged to me. I had lost everything, so the gift of the box gave me that hope, this belongs to me, and it really filled my heart. I realized God gave me what I was always in need of. I made a choice to personally seek him. Today, I have a family and I'm no longer an orphan. I know I'm chosen. Someone took their time to work hard and to pack my shoebox, and God used them to give me hope and to feel what my heart was in need of. So today, if you hear the voice of God, do not harden your heart. The harvest is plentiful, but the workers are few. So I'm asking you to go prepare a gift today. Pack a shoebox. Give someone hope and love somebody today. And spread the gospel.
In Psalm 140, verse 6, we read, I say to the Lord, you are my God. Give ear to the voice of my pleas for mercy, O Lord. In this spirit, let us pray. Most holy Heavenly Father, we praise you for calling us together here to partake of your blessings. We thank you for inviting us to your table of Holy Communion and declaring us forgiven and worthy to take the elements. We appreciate the Holy Spirit's guidance, and we appreciate each other. Help us to grow in our commitment to the faith. Together we pray for the body of Christ, his church. Help us to be examples of Jesus' love and dedication. Protect missionaries and Christians in areas of persecution. Help the Ukrainians to achieve peace and to recover. Help victims of natural disasters like Hurricane Ian to get back to normal. Bless our president, Congress, and courts, and all civil workers. Guide the citizens of the United States on Tuesday as we vote. Keep the elections above reproach, and let your choices for government office become obvious. Help winners and defeated candidates to be humble and grateful. Prepare us for communion as we now sing together the Lord's Prayer in his name. Our scripture for today, you've already heard part of it in the call to worship, comes from Paul's letter to the church at Ephesus, the second chapter, beginning at the 8th verse. For by grace you have been saved through faith, and this is not your own doing, it is the gift of God, not a result of works, so that no one can boast. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Grace, mercy, and peace be unto you from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.
Thank you, Bud. Tuesday. There is a blood moon Tuesday, if you know what that means. Get out and vote. But make sure, as a Christian, if you call yourself by the name of Jesus Christ, you have a responsibility to vote under his word. You vote with God's direction, not ever whatever willy-nilly idea you come up with. If you can't align your vote with God's word, don't bother. Okay, there. That's the lecture for this morning. No, it's not. Look. You see, for those of you who can't find your ballots or whatever it might mean, we have this like lost and found basket, and it's overflowing with glasses, even prescription glasses. Got some cool shades here. I might, you know, I got some pink ones, but please, would y'all help us out? And yeah, so I'm going to just, Tim, would you take these and set them on the front chair for us, please? I don't trust myself on these stairs. It's been a rough week. There we go. Yeah, thank you. All right. And one other thing, men, don't forget we've got breakfast at Tivoli's 8 o'clock tomorrow. You don't want to miss that. That's a lot of fun. So be sure that you are there. Oh, there is another thing. We've got too much going on around here, but what's happening this week? It's Veterans Day, isn't it? Our Trail Life Troop is actually marching in the Veterans Day Parade, so I hope you'll go out for that. And also next Sunday, we'll be acknowledging our veterans, and if you as a veteran have any pictures, any paraphernalia that you might like to bring in so that we might just remember with you and give glory to God for your service, we invite you to do that. So we'll have a display table set up, but bring it in this week if you can. That way we can kind of arrange it nicely. So y'all are so quiet out there. Is the effect that fast that you suddenly feel the anesthesiologist at work up here? How many of you actually use Twitter? Anybody use Twitter? I think I see two or three hands of people out there. Twitter, can you believe it was sold for $44 billion and nobody really uses it? Amazing. Amazing. Of course, you know who bought it, and you know it was Elon Musk. What kind of an interesting name is that? Of course, he's from South Africa. But he's only known as well as the richest guy in the world with $195 billion in the bank or investments, depending on where the stock market is. You know, it's just the way it is. It kind of fluctuates a little, but he's a business magnate, and he's an investor, and he is known as the world's richest man. Now, would you call that success? Boy, yeah. Whatever you think about Elon Musk, you've got to admit, the guy's pretty amazing. He was born in 1971. That makes him, well, almost as old as we are. And yet he's the founder and CEO and chief engineer of SpaceX, he was also the co-founder of Angel Investors. He's the CEO and product architect of Tesla, the founder of the Boring Company. I love that. They bore tunnels, just in case you didn't know. What's that? So's the pastor. Oh, thanks. Yeah, I'm a part of the Boring Company. Get the duct tape out there, Sherry. Boy, you know, you guys are dishing it out today. He was the co-founder of Neuralink and OpenAI, which is artificial intelligence. He's the president of the Musk Foundation, and now, of course, he's the owner and CEO of Twitter, which we don't use. All of this has had me thinking this last week. How successful is successful enough? If Elon Musk is the standard for success, how well are we doing? Really? I mean, we do live in Sun City Grand, after all, and I know people here who actually have four or five houses. Not in our congregation. That's in that rich church down the road. But, you know, we've got people who've got a little bit of money. We've had some success represent. I know y'all. You're not a bunch of losers. I'm just waiting. Don't say anything about your pastor. I mean, really, most of us around here can swing a golf club pretty well or a pickleball paddle or whatever it might be. Not me. I don't do that. We do pretty well. But let me ask you, how many of you have launched rockets into space, dug tunnels beneath the earth, and created a successful branch of the auto industry lately? Anyone? I mean, how many of us can claim that we've had a movie made about our work in artificial intelligence? You remember which one that was? The Iron Giant. How many of you have actually revolutionized at least six different industries and are worth even more, well, let's just say are worth just a meager $1 billion? Any billionaires here? If there are, please come see me. We need to talk about your tithe. I mean, most of us don't want to be connected with poverty. Most of us want to be connected with success. But I'll tell you a little secret. The best and the brightest live under the pressure, under a pressure that's killing them. And it robs them of so much joy. Mr. Musk has been estranged from his father. He's had three divorces. He's been the target of sexual misconduct allegations and describes himself not as a micromanager, but as a nanomanager. Whoo, that's really bad. And he then claims that he is cash poor. Anybody believe that, really? I'll take a little cash poor that way. And yet, by the world's standards, if you think about it, he is considered the most successful man in the world. Well, that makes me wonder how much success is enough. Some of you remember, and I've got a few illustrations here at the beginning. Normally, we get right into the scriptures, but we're going to just talk a little bit this morning before we do that. Some of you remember a guy named Al Davis. Anybody remember who Al Davis was? Sure. Anybody here an Oakland Raiders fan? We're praying for you. We're praying for you, too, just saying. All right. You know, they've always been the Oakland Raiders. See, all right, I've opened up a can of worms here. I can see that. But look, you know, Al Davis died about 10 years ago. And Al Davis was a kid from Brooklyn who became the general manager of the Oakland Raiders when he was only 33 years old. He was the youngest guy in professional football to do that, and he wasn't even a particularly gifted athlete. He did it by sheer tenacity. In an occupation full of the toughest people in the world, nobody was tougher than Al Davis. Do I hear an amen out there? Thank you, Brother James. Yeah, his standard to, you know, was a commitment to excellence. The motto of the Raiders under Al Davis was unforgettable. Anybody remember it? That's it. You see, I told you it was unforgettable. That motto perfectly fits Al Davis. He fought to become an owner of the Raiders, even though he didn't come from a lot of money like Elon Musk. He named the first Latino coach of in the NFL, head coach, that is. He named the first African-American head coach in the NFL. He was famous for taking misfits, renegades, and rebels, people other organizations weren't willing to accept, and putting them out on the field. And by sheer will, he led the Raiders to how many Super Bowls? Five. Now, they didn't win them all. They're not like the Steelers. Okay, Steelers are having a rough year. They're having a rough year. They're rebuilding. But who's going to beat the Steelers in the end for that number of Super Bowls? Who said Chiefs? They've got a long way to go to earn all those rings. But, you know, there are legions of devoted followers across the country who call themselves the Raider Nation. And when Al Davis was around, no one questioned who was in charge. A newspaper reported once, if you remember newspapers, that a new player asked Davis, well, who negotiates the contracts for the Raiders? Al Davis responded, young man, I do the hiring. I do the firing. I decide how many waste baskets we have in the office. See, Davis wouldn't back down from anybody. He sued the NFL to move the Raiders from Oakland to Los Angeles, and then he sued them again to move the Raiders from Los Angeles back to Oakland. Now they're in Vegas. He was such a feisty guy. NFL Films rated this guy as having one of the top 10 feuds of the NFL for all time. Most of the feuds are between a couple of teams, such as the Bears and the Packers, but the number one feud of all time was between Al Davis and the entire NFL. He took them all on. He could be extraordinarily generous and loyal, but he wasn't given to tortured self-doubt or false modesty. When the New York Yankees lost their beloved George Steinbrenner, Al Davis said, "I judge sports figures based on individual achievement, team achievement, and contributions to the game." George was right up there with me as number one. How do you judge a life? How does God judge a life? How much winning is enough? How do we compare to Al Davis? And if he's the standard for winning, how many of you have won 3 Super Bowls? Tim? He just won. Okay. I mean, have you set the record for the most Hall of Fame presentations ever? How many of you have a colossal group of followers around the country that take on your name? How much winning is enough? Now, here's a question. I'll bet Sherry knows the answer, and maybe Betty does, but have you ever heard of Roger Williams? Anybody here heard of Roger Williams? Yeah, actually, a few of you have. He was the first pianist to have his own star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame. He started playing the piano when he was 3 years old. Who does that? I did that. Ding, 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 ding. You know, by the time he was 9, he could play anything by ear, anything. He was a prodigy. He received a scholarship to go to Juilliard, and he went on to become the pianist to the president. Wow. I mean, starting all the way back with Harry Truman, he played for 9 consecutive presidents. Of all the pianists who've ever lived, he was the only one to have a number one song on the Billboard charts. He's the best-selling pianist of all times. He had 18 gold and platinum records. He had not only that, but he won a boxing championship in the Navy during World War II. Stand up and salute all the Navy veterans. So how talented is talented enough? How do we compare to Roger Williams? Well, Sherry's the closest, I think. But, you know, if he's the standard for talent, how do we measure up? How many of you took piano lessons while you were growing up? Anybody? Yeah. How many of you stuck with it? Well, 1, there you go. All right. So how many millions of records have you sold? You've probably sold quite a few if you stuck with it, right? Yeah. There you go. There you go. How many of you have received gold stars? I did in kindergarten, performed on TV, played for 9 presidents, and won a Navy boxing tournament. Championship. Whatever. All right, now let's get to another subject. How attractive is attractive enough? Now, I know that you're saying, well, Pastor, you set the standard. You really do. I mean, really. Why is my wife laughing maniacally back there? I don't get it. Oh, thank you, honey. Even as he's short, fat, and balding, too. See, all kidding aside, do you realize how many beauty queens and movie stars who were dazzlingly beautiful as a younger person are now really hard on the eyes? I mean, you've seen these side-by-side pictures, haven't you? When you've been online, you go, oh my goodness, look at that one. Whoa. You know, and thousands and thousands of people can claim this status. You see, if you're young and you're physically attractive, people probably will say, wow, you look good. But if you live long enough and you hit a certain age in life, and people will add, they'll add a little phrase. Now, I want everybody to understand this only applies to the men in the room and only a handful of them. But there's this little phrase people will add, you look good for your age. You know what I'm saying? You know, a few of you might relate to this. I mean, your body now has a little bit of flab and maybe a few wrinkles, liver spots, varicose veins. You look good, not in absolute terms, but in comparison to other deteriorating, flabby people. So how attractive is attractive enough? I mean, we're in this series called Nothing More, Nothing Less, and Nothing Else. It's based on the foundational beliefs of the Christian faith called the five solas, the sola scriptura. That's the Latin term for, you know, alone, okay? Sola scripture, by scripture alone. Sola Christos, by Christ alone. Sola gratia, by, that's what we're talking about today. So we've been through a couple of these already, but only by grace means that only by grace we have been saved. Grace is all over the Bible. Even in the Old Testament, for those of you who are taught that back in the Old Testament, that was a God of wrath, and in the New Testament, we got a God of grace. I was taught that in mainline liberalism. Blech, excuse me. Can I do that as a pastor? That's not true. You find the grace of God all the way back to Adam and Eve. We can have that conversation on Tuesday morning at 11 o'clock if you want to join my Genesis class. So we have grace all over the Bible. We've got Paul writing the words to the church at Ephesus that Bud just read. Remember what? For by grace you have been saved through what? Faith. And this not of your own doing. It is the gift of God, not the result of, so that no one can. See, some of you are getting it already. This is good. All right. We live in this boasty society, don't we? We think we've earned what we have. Especially when we're looking at those 401k. Oh, no, anyway. We think we're the reason why we're so successful and talented and beautiful. But Paul says that we are saved not by any of that, but by grace. All that we have is because of God's grace. The old definition of grace is unmerited what? Favor. You are good for something, Doug. That's good. Thank you. We have not earned a doggone thing, friends. Not a doggone thing. Everything that we have, everything that we are, everything that we will ever be was entrusted to us by the living God. And what we do with these things makes all the difference. Now, but it doesn't make all the difference in terms of earning our salvation. The ancient Greeks used the word grace, unmerited favor, when a strong person would help somebody else out who was weak, needy, and dependent. The weak person couldn't succeed on his own, and that's grace. Grace is God's choice to love, forgive, embrace, accept, and help us when we have done nothing to earn it. Now, some of you may have heard, I always like this, some people pick it apart theologically, but I like the old God's riches at Christ's expense. Say it with me. God's riches at Christ's expense. That's pretty good. That's pretty good. We could probably take that farther, but, you know, that's a good start. If grace came to us as a person, it would most likely say, well, stop. Just stop what you're doing. You don't have to be any more successful than you are right now. You don't have to win any more golf tournaments, pickleball tournaments. Some of you are saying, yeah, that's right. I don't. I can't. You don't have to be any more talented than you are. You don't have to look any better than you do. And by the way, you look pretty good to me. All those things are gifts of grace from God. You can't boast about them. See, friends, it's not bad to succeed. I want to make sure that I say it's not bad to succeed. It's not bad to excel. It's not bad to aspire to certain things. It's not bad to win. It's not bad to be smart. It's not bad to be talented. I mean, I know I've got all those gifts, but God can use those things for, I'm kidding about that. God can use all of those things for his glory, but they will never, ever, 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 ever save you. Well, but Pastor, I pray a whole lot. Well, that'll bridge the gap about that much if the bridge goes from that wall to that wall, or if the gap goes from that wall to that wall. Well, Pastor, I gave some money to the local rescue mission. Good, good. That's another little inch. Okay. I was kind to the, you know what, friends? All these things, all of our good works, as we're told in scriptures, are like filthy rags in the sight of God, unless they are generated from a heart of gratitude for what Christ has done for us. They're just filthy rags. Only when they're generated from that heart of gratitude do they have any long-term, namely eternal, effect. Grace might say to us, your hunger for those items, friends, all these things, is idolatry. Because they determine the level of your happiness. Trying to be good enough causes you to overwork yourself. You fail to see the gift of the moment. You overlook people and you neglect what really matters. What does really matter? To know God. To know his word. To glorify God, to enjoy him forever. Some of us are actually just starting to realize this. A lot of us are. And even as a pastor, it took me a long time to really get it. And we're so focused on ourselves sometimes that we don't stop to really pray on a daily basis. Oh, we're retired. We got tons of time, right? Do we pray, really? Do we read scripture, really? Maybe we want to serve ourselves. I'm retired. I can live it up. I got at least for the moment a big 401k, shrinking 401k, you know. But our hearts are often not generous. The old alternative to grace that the Bible talks about is salvation by works. I can't be good enough, and I can't merit salvation on my own. Even people who don't believe in God believe in some form of salvation by works, don't they? Well, I never killed nobody. You know, look at all the good I did. I remember Mayor Bloomberg when he said, when I get to heaven, I'll just strut through the gates right on up to the throne of God. And because, you know, I deserve it. I was like, you don't strut up to the throne of God. We pray for former Mayor Bloomberg. See, it just depends on how we define salvation. All of us want to be saved, don't we? We all want to be free. We all need it. We all know it. And that sense will never go away in us. Our culture, however, redefines what salvation means. Now it means to become largely economically free. Oh, I can afford anything. Or it's therapeutic. Salvation will come if we're successful enough. Then we'll be happy enough, so we think. But we have the sense that we're not there yet. So we keep running. We try harder. We climb higher. We push our kids and our grandkids to do this and that and be this and that. Well, if you're pushing them to be a Christian, fine. Don't push too hard. Remember, be led by the Spirit. But for all that other junk in life, I mean, look at where we are now. We pushed all our young ladies. I'm going to offend some people here. We pushed all our young ladies to have great careers. Now we don't have any families or kids. And there are talented ladies out there. Trust me, I've seen lots and lots of them. But we are suffering as a nation because we've forgotten what family is. We've forgotten what motherhood is. We forgot long ago what fatherhood is. Because we were pushing, 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 pushing. We wouldn't stop. We, the church, needs to repent. Grace would say, you got to stop. You can't be successful enough. And if you try, it's too hard here. You're going to fall flat on your face. You can't be talented enough or smart enough or tough enough or good enough. Grace is good. But grace is not soft. Grace is concerned with making people what? Feel good? No. You remember the old hymn, Amazing Grace, don't you? What's that one line say? I think second stanza. It's got a zillion stanzas. 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear. Who wrote that? John Newton. John Newton was an old slave trader before he became a Christian. He lived a terrible life, and he found grace. He was then able to say, 'Twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved.' How precious did that grace appear the hour I first believed. Seems strange to us that grace could teach somebody's heart to fear. I think grace would say to us, it's important that you pay attention to the uneasiness you have about not feeling good enough. You can't relieve yourself of that feeling by accomplishments, by having a stronger will, or by going to the gym more. We need God. You need to be saved from what sin has done and what it's doing to your soul. We need to be saved from sin. Sin has messed up who we are as individuals. It's ruined our relationship to the universe. It's ruined our relationship with the living God. I love what John Ortberg shares about this. He's got a great story. Thanks for mentioning his name. He's got a great story about some friends of theirs who had a little girl named Shauna. She was 4 years old, and she was very strong-willed. And she was taught that she was to stay in a certain area when she would ride her tricycle. She was given very clear boundaries. Her mom became so frustrated, though, because she kept going outside of the boundaries, and she went outside of the front yard one day, and she said, "All right, Shauna, that's it. Look, here's a tree. Here's the edge of the driveway. Here's our sidewalk. You can drive your tricycle in between the tree and the driveway, and you can't take it beyond that. If you do, I will spank you." "I'm going back inside the house, but I have a big picture window here, and I will watch you. And if you ride beyond those boundaries, I will come out, and there will be a spanking." Do you think Shauna was intimidated by that? Not at all. She stuck out her little hip, and she said, "Well, you better spank me now, because I got places to go." I mean, that's a picture of the human heart, isn't it? The human heart will, the human will has become corrupt. The human will's turned from God. The heart is corrupt and all of our hearts are corrupt, aren't they? Here's the problem. Because corruption is universal, because it affects every person like aging and deterioration, we become so used to it. We just get used to it in this world, whether it's injustice or poverty or violence or abuse or apathy. We get used to it because it's in all of us. But God never gets used to it. It never looks okay to him. Never, ever. He never looks at this broken, corrupt world and says, "Eh, no big deal." Grace isn't like that. God's standard is the sinless purity of his very nature. Did you get that? He isn't severe or unreasonable. The only conditions under which his creation can flourish are justice, love, and shalom. In God's eyes, in a morally sane vision, sin is the horror of our souls, and it should be of this nation. We are a nation that desperately needs to repent. And we as individuals need to be the ones that start that process. I want to read to you a list of words, and I want to see if any of these characterize you. Trust me, I've looked at them in relationship to myself. But listen to these words: prideful, judgmental, cold-hearted, apathetic toward the poor, greedy, envious, lustful, unfaithful, deceitful, promise breaker, secretly cruel, cowardly, stubborn, self-centered, careless, joyless, complaining, loveless. Somebody's playing a tune out there because they're going, yeah, all of them. Yeah, they're all. Grace would say spiritual and moral sanity begins with this recognition. God, I have neglected you, and I have neglected your ways. I've ignored you, and I've ignored your way of life. I've defied you, I've defied your ways. I shot my little hip out, and I said, better spank me now, because I got places to go. There's something wrong. There's something broken within me, and I cannot fix it. Grace actually came to earth one day. Did, literally. The Gospel of John says, for the law was given through Moses, grace and truth came through Jesus Christ. Jesus shows us how grace lives. And he went to the cross and he showed us how grace dies. Go ahead, lift that screen. Let's remember the cross. Jane, would you lift the screen, please? Paul wrote, all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God and are justified only as grace is seen as and understood as a gift. By grace we're declared to be forgiven. We're embraced. We're accepted freely by his grace through the redemption that came through Christ Jesus. Grace would say to you today, you can have acceptance, forgiveness, and the love that you crave no matter who you are or where you've been. Stop trying to earn your salvation. Stop trusting in your own works, your own accomplishments, and yourself. Humble yourself. Receive God's gift of grace and do it as a child. Like a child. Grace would also say, look, I want to invite you to check out of the culture of performance that you're currently in, and I want you to step into a world of grace. When you wake up in the morning, I want you to give yourself to grace. When you go to bed at night, give yourself grace. When you have a challenge in life, rely on grace. When you mess up, turn to grace. People sometimes wonder why I'm so joyful as a pastor. It's not as a pastor that makes me joyful. That can be daunting sometimes. It's because of God's grace, his love, his mercy, his kindness, and everything that flows from it. Now, here's the deal. You can understand this. You can believe in God. You can affirm all of this and still not be a follower of Jesus Christ. A question remains. Have you responded to grace? What's it mean to give your heart to God? All you have to do is acknowledge your sin and offer him your heart. And I'm going to invite everyone to repeat after me this prayer. And if you've made it, if you say this prayer for the first time today and mean it, come see me or one of the elders. God, I confess to you that I've done wrong. There's brokenness inside me, and I can't fix it. I want to be forgiven. I want to be loved. I'll stop comparing myself to other sinners. I can never be good enough. I can never give enough. I acknowledge that Jesus died on the cross in order to save me from my sin, my pride, my selfishness, my hate, and all the darkness inside me. I recognize he somehow paid the debt I could never pay to you, God. He died the death I should have died. I want to receive your forgiveness and your love. Not because of anything I've done, but because of what Jesus has done for me. I receive his free gift of grace. God, I want to surrender all to you. Several years ago, I was flying with a friend in a Piper Cherokee 7. Some of you know what that is. This pilot actually, you know, said, hey, we've got some smooth sailing here. You want to take the yoke? And I was like, okay, I'll take over, and, you know, I'll just show you how to fly a plane. Oh. It didn't take long, and we hit some turbulence, and that plane was doing this and shuddering, and I was like, man, it's just the two of us up here with this rattle-trap plane that was built in 1973. My knuckles were white, and I didn't know what to do, and the plane was bouncing and shuddering. I think my friend was having kind of fun with this, and so I looked at my friend, and I said, look, you take control. And he said, are you sure you want to do that? Thankfully, he did. Thankfully, he took control. And when things calmed down a bit, he said, you know, that's the way I felt the day I surrendered the control of my life over to the Lord Jesus. I needed him to be the pilot of my life. And it changed my heart. And my life's flight patterns have been different ever since. You see, friends, when you give your heart to God, you receive forgiveness. And love is a free gift of grace. But you need to surrender. You just need to say, look, God, I'm giving my life to you. And I want to walk in your grace every day. Some of you have already done this. And right now you're saying, God, thank you. Or, God, I just want a fresh experience of your grace. Some of you have never done this. Never done this. And some of you are thinking, your sin's too horrific to be forgiven. There's no sin, friends, that grace cannot cover. The blood of Christ is powerful enough to cover every single sin you've committed, and some of you need to come to my office so we can review those for the next few weeks. We've committed a lot of sins, but forgiveness comes from Jesus Christ. Heavenly Father, thank you for your word. Thank you for the power of the cross. Thank you for the transformation that you work in us as your sons and daughters. We relish the joy of our relationship with you, and we lay our hearts before you in Jesus' name. Believe in God the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From then she shall come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. You may be seated. Friends, as we come to this Holy Supper, we're reminded of two things. Three things maybe. I'm a preacher. We have to have three. We're reminded first of the work that Christ did for us on the cross, that it was his effort, it was his blood shed that causes us to be able to participate in this supper. And I would urge you, if you have not yet received Christ into your heart as Lord and Savior, just refrain, not because we don't love you, but because we want to see you here next month at the table. If you've got some sin that you haven't yet worked through, if there's some relationship that's very broken and you know there's something you can do about it before the Lord, do that and then come back to the table next month. Second thing that this reminds us of is the fact that Jesus Christ is coming again. And one day we will be with him at the great feast on Mount Zion. And we will celebrate, and we will look at one another and say, man, you don't just look good, you look great. I always knew you could be this way. And you know, it won't be just about looks. It'll be about hearts. It'll be about true, irrepressible joy. And our lives will be flooded with everything that is imaginably good. Well, friends, first we remember now the night that our Lord was betrayed. And as we do so, I want to just lift up our hearts. Let's lift up our hearts to him in prayer. Heavenly Father, we confess to you that apart from you, we can do no good. There is no good in us. But we thank you, O Lord, that in Christ Jesus that we are free, that we are forgiven, that we are given new life, and we are given a new status as your sons and daughters, as a royal priesthood, a holy nation. Oh Lord, as we ask you to consecrate these elements, we would pray that you would consecrate our hearts, our very lives, that you would be glorified, and that you would knit us together by the power and presence of your Holy Spirit now in this place. For we pray this in the precious and powerful name of Christ our Savior and Lord. Amen. On the night that our Lord was betrayed, he was with the disciples in the upper room. And after giving thanks, he took the bread and he broke it, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Oh, wait. We're a little rusty at this, friends. Yours, oh, we've got it right. Go ahead. Grace. Thank you. Beloved, the body of Christ, the bread of heaven, given for you.
After the same manner also, Jesus took the cup, saying, "This cup is the new covenant of my blood, which is poured out for you and for many for the remission of sins. This do as often as you drink of it in remembrance of me." The blood of Christ poured out for you. St. Paul adds, "For as often as you eat of this bread and drink of this cup, you do show the Lord's death until he comes." May we pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the gift of your Son, for his spiritual presence in these elements, and thank you for the outpouring of the Holy Spirit to lead us into all truth. Let us always be filled with gratitude and respond appropriately. To your glory, in Jesus' name, amen.
Let's stand together. Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. I once was lost, but now am found. I was blind, but now
you've heard the words of the prophet Zephaniah say in chapter 3, verse 17, "The Lord your God is with you. He is mighty to save. He will take great delight in you. He will quiet you with his love. He will rejoice over you with singing. Go, therefore, as ones who've been saved by grace, spread the good news. Let people know who Jesus Christ is. Reflect him in your every word. Reflect him in your every deed. And be strengthened by his word and in prayer. Go, therefore, as his sons and daughters, as his royal priesthood, as his holy nation, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen."